Hi everyone, my name is Kanika Manga and I'm with Rheum Now, and we are at the American College of Rheumatology annual meeting, and wow, what a great start it's been. And I'm extremely excited to have Dr. Revelle here with me right now. Can't wait to ask him lots of questions for us. Hi Dr. Revelle, how are you doing?
Kanika, good to see you.
Nice to see you. So first off, congratulations for being ACR Master. That's amazing.
Well, I sort of feel a question of having survived that long, I mean, given the alternative, but it's an honor. It truly is an honor. I've been working with the ACR for, nearly 40 years, and this is a very great honor to have been selected for this.
Well, it's my honor to be here with you right now. What advice would you have for people that want to pursue a career in rheumatology?
Well, this is a very good time to be going to rheumatology. We have a much clearer concept of pathogenesis, better aids in diagnosis, and by all means, more and effective treatments, albeit expensive. And we really can now do something for our patients. We are taught in diagnosis and to be skilled therein, and we know that early diagnosis and early initiation of effective therapy is very important in outcome, and that we have the tools now for that early diagnosis with genetics, with biomarkers, with new imaging techniques and the like.
That's extremely true, and of course I'm biased and I love rheumatology as well. So Dr. Revelle, how do you feel the field has changed over the years?
Well, when I joined, we were called the American Rheumatism Association when I first joined this organization. Actually, the first meeting I attended was as a medical student in 1976, so that it goes back quite a ways. Things have changed a great deal. The specialty has grown enormously. The awareness of what it is and of the diseases involved therein, and especially, like I said, with this growing awareness, we can diagnose earlier. The technology has remarkably move forward, and the ACR has more and more been enabled to really help us in our mission.
That's actually very true. Now, what are you most excited to see at this year's meeting? What session are you most excited to attend?
Well, the plenaries are remarkable, and they're especially highlighting novel treatments and novel pathogenesis. I'm just completely bowled over at how fast the scenery is changing, and how much that we're going to be able to do. And it makes this especially all the more exciting. I think there's so many different sessions that one can attend, so many ways that appeal to an individual's own focus or expertise, that it's like being a kid in a candy store. The only danger is getting diabetic.
That's true. It's a Disney World for rheumatologists. So I am extremely excited about the Hench lecture that you're going to give us on Tuesday morning. Can you tell us a little bit more about what's in store for us?
Well, that's a special passion of mine. Chronic back pain is a major challenge in this country. It's the leading cause of disability. Huge, billions of dollars in lost productivity, work wages, disability funding, and all that kind of stuff. It's not well managed by the community, especially by the rheumatology community, where looking at some insurance databases, only 14% of patients with chronic back pain ever even encounter a rheumatologist. The problem is that one-third, in the NHANES study, 20% of the U.S. population, 20% has chronic back pain. One-third of them have chronic inflammatory back pain. And of course, that's a symptom and raises suspicion high for spinal arthritis. With the diminishing manpower we have in rheumatology, which will turn around, this represents a special challenge because most of the people don't encounter rheumatologists because some of the novel terminology, like that ankylosing spondylitis is now synonymous with radiographic axial spinal arthritis. All this is unknown to primary care practitioners. And this is very troubling because spinal arthritis represents a group of diseases where so many novel and effective treatments have come forward, but they work by far the best and do their best job preventing disability and deformity if initiated early in the disease course. So this is a big focus of mine. We're going to start with looking at the specter of chronic back pain in the United States, to chronic inflammatory back pain, talking about non-radiographic axial spinal arthritis, the challenge that it represents, especially in women, because the majority of people with non-radiographic are women, and too many are called fibromyalgia. And again, it's an issue. We know that these medications work very well even before the x-rays turn positive, which is 7 to 10 years after the onset of symptoms. I'm going to really be focused on that. And finally, to where we've gone with this, with some of the new advances in genetics, where we're understanding more and more what causes disease, and especially where you got a gene, you've got a drug. I mean, the genes predict the drugs that are going to work. All the novel treatments have been planned by the genetics. And so this is important knowledge to have. I just wish that we had the manpower and the focus to better address this at a national level from the denominator of chronic back pain.
Thank you so much for that explanation. I'm now even more excited and thrilled about the lecture. Once again, thank you so much for talking to us at Room Now. And for everyone watching this, please log on to roomnow.com for more information. Thank you.